My name is Susan Lexon, and I'm the coordinator of the Liverpool Scans chapter. And we're delighted to welcome you here this morning, especially as you've braved the elements. And unfortunately, we have had a number of cancellations because of the weather. But the good news is that we are recording our talk this morning. It will be available on the website for a couple of weeks. So if you really enjoy what you hear tonight or today, you might tell your friends that, look, you can pick it up with a cup of coffee or a drink over the next couple of weeks if you're what they might have to say. I just have a few quick comments before we invite Mike to the podium for your medal. Firstly, we would like to begin by acknowledging that we are in Mi'kma'ki, the ancestral and unceded territory covered by the treaties of peace and friendship. We are all treaty people. I would also like to acknowledge our local committee who brings SCANS courses and presentations to you. They are Tina Tucker over here, Jan Godfrey over there, Pam Oliver over here, and Patricia Purcell is away on a cruise in Alaska, and Betsy Hart, whom you do know, is stepping away from the committee. So those are us who bring it to you. And we're also pleased to have with us Fern Jordan from the Mahone Bay chapter. She's the coordinator of that program, and I'm sure many of you do go to Mahone Bay, and we can thank Fern and her committee for what they do there.
Thank you, Susan.
Our format this morning is pretty straightforward. We allot about 2 hours, give or take, and a break at some point. Mike needs to have a break. As I say, it's being recorded, so we'll be particularly interested if you want to ask a question so that you can stand up and we can hear your voice. We'd like everybody, you know, broadly to be able to hear your questions and the answers. Mike LaLeune is our speaker this morning, and he has been working at senior levels with Olympic organizing committees around the world to bring you the spectacle of the modern winter and summer games. When I heard Mike talk about these experiences last year, I was fascinated, and I thought that others might be interested as well. And he kindly agreed to share his experiences with us today. So please join me in welcoming Mike to Liverpool and to our annual SCANS public presentation.
Thanks, Susan. Good morning. It's great to be here, despite the weather, and thank you all for coming out. This morning I'm going to take you through a bit of the background I have with organizing the Olympic Games. We're not going to talk about the athletes. Are there any Olympians here? Or family members of Olympians? Okay, whereas we do have lots from Nova Scotia. I mean, historically, there also have been lots. I wouldn't have been surprised. I was meeting with some friends earlier in the week in Lunenburg, and there was an Olympian who had joined us there. Well, that's not so important, because we're going to talk about really behind the scenes. Now, everybody's seen the Olympics. I'm sure you've all watched the television broadcasts many times. What I do is behind the scenes and behind the curtain, you know, the Wizard of Oz kind of curtain. The Olympic Games has a number of components. There's Olympic Games, there's Paralympic Games, there's Youth Games, there's regional championships like the Asian Olympics, the European Games are all part of that Olympic family. The getting to the Olympic Games is really a piece of drama. Now, in my past life, I was an actor at the Stratford Shakespearean Festival, so I know something about drama. I found that there's such a tremendous similarity between the experience of for an athlete, but also for me, working behind the scenes with the drama of the Olympics, the drama of the competition, the drama of organizing it, and sometimes it gets a bit intense. We're going to talk a little bit about some of those little crazy moments later on this morning, but I wanted to give you a kind of look of about the dramatic focus of how this all comes together. So I'm going to play for you a quick little video. This is, for me, one of the great dramatic moments of the Summer Olympic Games. This is the men's 100 meter final. This particular race was in London, at the London Olympic Games in 2012, where I worked. So let's just have a look at the opening sequence.
The Olympic men's 100 meters final. Thompson, Trinidad. Powell, Jamaica. Gay, USA. Blake, Jamaica. Gatlin, USA. Bolt, Jamaica. Bailey, USA. Martina of the Netherlands.
On your mark.
That's the start of the drama.
Yes.
Right? You can see, you can feel it. The load up to this is, it actually takes a month. Because when they first arrive in the city, there are 70 sprinters, all of whom are gold medalists because they haven't competed yet. You weed them down over the period of the week of the competition. Then this broadcast happens and they come out of the tunnel and there's a lot of hoopla about all that and the introductions and their pedigree and their accomplishments, each one of those people. And it's all about these characters. They're all completely different. Their mannerisms, they're all characters in themselves. And so that forms the real basis of this drama. But it happens in every sport. I just particularly like this because it is very dramatic. Now, here's what we're going to do, because we're not going to talk about the athletes, but I'm going to tell you the stuff that I care about that you're going to see in this picture. So in this image, of course, there's the eight finalists. You see there's nine lanes in this track, because occasionally you have a ninth runner in a preliminary race, so there's nine lanes. So the things that I care about in this image are the stuff that happens behind. So they step into some starting blocks. The starting blocks are all the same. They're very fancy. But they have nine of them at the stadium, but they also have another nine that are backup in case something breaks. The track itself costs £3.5 million to build. We have three of them. Of course, on the side here, you'll see some pictures of other people involved here, like camera operators. There's one, two, three, four, five, six camera operators. This is a camera rail. Just moves along with the athletes running. So that has three cameras on it. There's a super slow-mo, a 4K, and an 8K camera. And behind here, you'll see, you might not be able to see very well, but these are technology boxes that have a starter, cables and connections all to that. Because it starts with the old-fashioned gun, but it's not really a gun, it's an electronic signal that's set to the blocks in the timers so that they can see how you get your time correct from the time you leave the blocks to the time you cross the line. So there's a whole lot of technology and a lot of wiring that happens, but you don't see any wiring. There's a reason you don't see it, because it's ugly. You make sure that it gets hidden. Now, in behind there, in that tunnel up here, are about, I don't know, probably, what do you think, 30 people, 40 people? They all have on an Olympic uniform. They're probably all from the sports volunteers or sports staff team who work in that athlete area behind to make sure that these athletes have everything that's necessary. Water, washrooms, and they're clean, and they know when to come out, so somebody's communicating with them. And so they're all out here watching. Spectators, there's 80,000 people in the stadium that day. I was there, actually, sitting at the finish line. You'll also notice behind the athletes is a group of orange people with orange on. There was a Dutch runner, and of course Holland and the Netherlands wears orange as their national color. That's his coaching team. Now, it's not just one coach. He has a physiotherapist, psychologist, fitness trainer. There's a whole group of people that are there to support one athlete. Now, they have many others that they're responsible for on the team, but they happen to be sitting directly behind the start line. You'll see also some color purple and branding. At the very top of the image is a screen. That's 36 meters wide. 36 meters is that's an awfully big screen. But that stadium holds 80,000 people. It's quite large. You see also some speakers hanging up there. There are 12 of those in the stadium. They each have, I think, 10 or 12 speaker units on it. Of course, it's all connected to a broadcast center. It's like a proper television, radio broadcast center inside that stadium, of course, to communicate what's going on and all the activities that are happening in the stadium. And behind there, you can't really see it, but there are flags around the stadium. Those, of course, are the 206 nations that compete. They have to be in the right order, not only hung correctly and the right flag, but they also have to be hung in the right order. And the right order is determined by the Olympic Committee as to who became members of the National Olympic Committee in their order of membership. So, while the drama happens on the field of play, the drama for me happens behind. And that's what I'm looking at. That's what I'm concerned about at the games. Well, the games are pretty big and pretty complicated. But I want to kind of start with something that you might more easily be able to relate to. This is the dinner party. It's not a dinner party that I've ever organized, but perhaps you have. I mean, we've all organized a birthday party or some friends or a dinner party at our house. And I can tell you, you did five things in order to host that party. First of all, you decided why we're going to have this. What's the reason behind it? It might be to celebrate some people or just to have some friends over. But then the next thing, of course, is who's coming? Is it one couple? Is it six people? Is it 106? Like, how many are coming to this thing? Then, is it a 4 o'clock? Is it an 8 o'clock? Is it a 10 in the morning? What's this? And what happens when we say the start time? Well, maybe we need some things to happen before that. Maybe there's a cake that arrives partway through this. What time is that happening? So you have a little schedule of events. And then you might decide on some stuff. With 100 people, I kind of like to visit with these friends, and so I don't really want to be handing plates around or asking people. I'll hire some few people to do that. Or it's a paper plate thing, so help yourself. Get your own plate. Or maybe I don't have enough champagne glasses because this is the 50th anniversary, and so I'll rent some. So you have to make some decisions about what it is you're going to do. And I'll bet you that you have a little notepad, old school pencil, paper, write down a few things. I need to contact this person. I've done that. You know, I got a list of stuff to organize to get this together. Well, let me tell you something. It's exactly the same thing as what I do with the Olympic Games. I have a little longer list, and it's a little more complicated. But they're exactly the same five things. There's no difference. The Olympic Games is the largest and most prestigious sporting event in the world. We'll talk mostly about the summer one because it's 10 times bigger than the Winter Games. So just to give you kind of size of what it is I'm looking after, Summer Olympic Games is not just one Olympic Games that you watch on television. It starts usually with torch relay, which happens up to 100 days before. This is the torch from Vancouver, which I got because I worked at the Games, not because I worked there, I got it, but I happen to have one. You can have a look if you want. That usually starts it off. The year before, you have test events. You have to test how all this is going to work. These are World Cup competitions. It's not just a bunch of youth that come out and test out your track and all. This is probably a World Junior Athletics Championship, so it's quite prestigious in its own right. There's the games themselves, the Paralympic Games, and a cultural festival is always attached to this. The cultural festival budget, in London, for example, was probably £300 million. That's a very substantial event in and of its own. So you've got a kind of conglomerate of activities. But the games themselves have 205 nations. I don't know how many nations there are in the world today, but there's not too many more than that. So most or almost all the nations in the world are members of the International Olympic Committee and have the right to compete. There's 30 different sports, 7,500 referees or officials, 10,500 athletes at one games, 45,000 volunteers. I mean, you have a local event, or you have an event here today. We have a few volunteers for sure, because that's the world relies, especially in Canada. We rely a lot on the volunteers. But we have a lot at the Olympic Games. 150,000 paid contractors and workforce for one Olympic Games. We give out 339 medals, sometimes an extra, because sometimes there's two gold medals awarded, which is a whole other story, but it's exciting when that happens, but rare. 5,600 hours of broadcast. Everything that happens in the Olympic Games is owned and recorded by the Olympic Broadcast Service. They record everything in the highest quality that you could ever imagine. I had the fortune of working in Pyeongchang, which is the Winter Games in 2018, as the broadcast manager for ice hockey. Extraordinary experience. The caliber was just over the top. I enjoyed it immensely working with those caliber people. I'll tell you a quick anecdote. We had 41 cameras for the men's ice hockey arena. 41. Hard to believe. You never even imagined using 41 cameras, but when there are 41 cameras and they're that good a quality, sometimes the stuff that's picked up is great, over the top. It's brilliant. 12 million meals are served at Summer Olympic Games. 12 million. 1 million pieces of sports equipment, shuttlecocks, starting blocks, 1 million pieces of equipment. 150,000 condoms.
Really?
There's a lot of testosterone. There's a lot of stuff going on. But imagine, you know, if you're an athlete, you've worked for a very long time under pretty strict confines of how you're going to get to your competition. After that, you've finished your competition, whether you won or not, it's a great release and now you can relax. Well, that's one way to do it, I suppose. So we know this saying, situs, altius, fortius, we know what that means. But I think it's also, this is a made up word, it's rather large. This is a photograph of the workforce in the office from Brazil. Now, this is about a year before the Olympic Games start. I'm going to just give you a sense of how we actually get to this point a year before the Games. We're a little less than a year before the next Games in Paris. So there's about, I think, 330 people, roughly, working at the Games at that time. You're awarded the, as a host, you're awarded the Games 7 years, sometimes more, but 7 years before the Olympic Games. So that's almost two cycles before. You probably had to make a bid for that, because it didn't just happen out of the blue. The bid itself could take you another 10, 15 years before you actually get awarded. It's almost unheard of to make a bid and get it right away. So you make a bid and you have to wait 4 years before you can do it again. So you'll do that a few times until you get awarded the Games, if you're fortunate enough to do that. So my role at the Games is to, I start about 4 years before the Games start. And my job is to build it, to operate it, and leave it better than when I started. So we'll talk a little bit how we get to that point. The key thing for all of us who do that, there's some of us who are what we call Olympic gypsies. we kind of move around, you know, from one Games to the next. Fortunately, I'm kind of tired of that run around the world. I've worked in 30 different countries and 40 different Olympic sports. It's time. I need a little break. I'm happy to be here today in Liverpool to do that. The work that goes into this is a pretty complicated piece of preparation. And one of our big jobs is to anticipate what's going to happen. So as a gypsy, you've been through this a few times before, you can kind of think, okay, I've seen this before. I know what's kind of to be expected, and see if you can pull it together. There's about 100 or 120 gypsies at any given time, and we all know each other very well. They're from all over the world, so it's been a great pleasure for me to do that and to work like that. I'm going to show you how this is kind of, quickly, I'll just show you how this is sort of put together. I mean, in behind the scenes, how we organize it. This is just a quick little graphic of how those 330 people were organized. This is just one venue. So we have 30 competition venues at any Summer Olympic Games. So one team starts 4 years out with just the people in the light blue. That's the sport manager, who is an expert in whatever sport it happens to be. There is a what we call overlay manager, which is usually an architect or designer who deals with structures and buildings, roads, infrastructure, and me, who is a generalist who has a pretty good idea of how all the rest of it goes together. Then we add some of the people from the core team as time goes along. And there are 40 different departments that are active on any venue. Every single one of those departments has somebody at the head of it who is world class. They're fantastic people, they're extremely experienced, they're incredibly gracious to work with, and we can accomplish a huge amount very quickly with people who have that kind of approach. And so it's always great fun, because it's very prestigious to work at the Olympic Games, but when you've got a team like that, that makes things much easier, much better. So it's split into these departments, and eventually the darker blue come on maybe a year before the Games, and so you end up with a team of, probably for your weekly meetings, you might have 100 people regularly every week, so if you work through probably, I don't know, 25,000 questions, if I had to guess, that's probably how many we start with. Yeah.
Mike, do you want questions to go along?
If you have a question, just shout it out.
Well, I was just wondering, of that group, what percentage would be based in this city?
Everyone.
Every, you know, from the country, the national.
Oh.
And does that matter?
It does matter, yeah, because part of why you would host the games is to benefit the local sports community so they gain experience working with international events. So on this venue team, for example, there might be 4 or 5 international people. The rest, the other 95, would probably be from the host country. And it's a wonderful experience, and I have done that in many different countries, and it's a great learning experience working in different cultures. We all work in different ways, you know, different cultures have a different approach. And
can we just take one step back? I wasn't sure whether to ask the question at the time. When you were talking about countries bidding to host, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but has there not been recent discussion where some countries are saying, no, it's too expensive, we really don't feel, you know, it's a return on investment despite the amount of money that's spent, what we need to put forward is just too much.
I'm going to come on to that.
Okay.
Because I think that's a really good point. We hear a lot about that.
Yeah.
It's a very valid concern. I'm going to come on to that in a few minutes.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Robert,
don't want to delay your presentation, but the training and experience and background to get these people capable of doing this at that stage with that team, does that come from your local hockey league, your provincial hockey league, your national hockey league, and then those people with that background then say, okay, I'm capable of this? How do you train?
Yes, this can absolutely start with that. I started in Halifax. So, yes, of course. And part of what we do is we're looking for people who have, who think in the right way and are prepared to learn, because we'll teach them. So I've often run an Olympic Academy for my staff who come to work for me in this venue, and we'll spend 6 weeks with 3 hours a day at the Olympic level of how you do it. So I'll take you from running a national ice hockey championship, which you know quite a deal about, and I'll help you get from there to here's what we do at the Olympics, because the gap is enormous. But it's the same as your dinner party. It's the same 5 questions. How you do it is slightly different, isn't it?
How did you get from starting in Halifax?
I'm going to come to that after as well.
I have a question about language. You talked about 95 of the 100 being from the local country or community.
Yeah.
Do you deal in English or do you deal in multiple languages?
Well, the International Olympic Committee works in French and English. Of course, you guys speak both French and English. But when you're in Pyeongchang or Tokyo or Rio, they work in the national language. International meetings happen in international language, which for the Olympics happens to be French or English. But the day-to-day work happens in the local language. I'll come on to it a little more when I talk about Rio, because that for me was a very big project, and I have a specific example I'll show you on that. There are 40 different, 100 different venues in the Summer Olympic Games. 30 of them are competition, and 40 of them are non-competition. So that's things like hotels. The Olympic Village, where all these 10,500 athletes have to live, is 10,000 apartments. Is a small town, probably a big town. there's a lot that goes into running that. The International Broadcast Center, with all the international television networks that come to broadcast, is 1 million square meters of space. That's a very large building. It's not competition, but you have to have one. It's pretty important. There's 30 training venues. If you come, for example, from a less wealthy country, you really may not have the facilities in your country to compete in your sport. So the Olympic Games opens 2 weeks before the competition for you to come to the country to get acclimatized and to do your final training. You don't do that in the Olympic Stadium because we're getting ready for the opening ceremonies and doing a whole lot of other things. But you go to the training venue. So the training venues, there are 30 of them at the Olympics or more, has exactly the same field of play you saw earlier. The track's the same, the facilities are the same, except it doesn't have broadcasters, spectators, or anything external. It's only about the training facility. So we have a bunch of other stuff that happens in behind the scenes as well. So I've worked on about 100 or so of these Olympic venues. But what I'm going to do is I'm just going to look at one of them because you couldn't possibly do 100 and you'd be bored to tears. This is Horse Guards. It's in London. It's a temporary venue. We have actually three kinds of Olympic venues, like this, which is totally temporary. And underneath, of course, is a gravel parade square. And when those games are over, all that gets moved away and it goes back to being a parade square. The other kind is an existing venue that we kind of fix up. So that might, like Calgary, for example, if they were doing the Winter Games, they use the same sliding center they used in '88. They'd upgrade it. It needs to be fixed a little bit. We need to upgrade a few things, fix the chillers and stuff like that. But the main structure of the building is pretty good, and then that stays in legacy. The other one is entirely new. We saw a picture of that in the Olympic Stadium. When we started there, it wasn't there. It's a brand new stadium. Stadiums these days, they start at about 350 million of your local currency. The new stadium in Los Angeles is, I think, 1.3 billion, roughly.
What's Paris going to cost?
I don't know. probably a lot. In this case, it's a temporary facility. If something happened to the royal family, as in a fatality during the Olympic Games, that takes precedence over the Olympic Games. So all this has to go. And should there have been an issue, there wasn't, but should there have been, this would have all been removed probably within about 4 to 5 days. It takes about 6 months to build it, but it would be gone so that it would serve its proper purpose and the competition would move to the training venue. Because it has the same field of play. That's a contingency that we have to be prepared for and think about, but in this particular case, that's how it works. So I'd like to talk more about a venue that I worked on in Brazil. Now, you were asking about language. This is the Deodoro Olympic Park. They have two Olympic parks in Rio, Olympic Games, one in Baja, and the other one in the north, it's called Deodoro, and that was my project. So when I arrived, this is what was there. This is a jungle. It's on the 1st Battalion Army base, and the Brazilian Army and I became very good colleagues and very good friends. And oddly enough, I have no military background at all, but we are still very good friends today. But they work in Portuguese. At the time, I didn't speak Portuguese, but I do now. I think it's quite important that if you're going to work in someone's country, you should probably do it in their language. First of all, you get things done a lot faster, but there's also a little more respect of what they're trying to accomplish. So I speak Portuguese. It was a bit of work, to pick it up, but it worked out fine. So this was the start of Deodoro, and it kind of looked like this. The These are videos that I took, so they're not particularly good, but you get the idea. Is 500 acres of land, and the entire project cost $1.2 billion US. We built two new light rail stations. We built a commuter rail section to Baja and another one to Ipanema. It has a new electric substation connected with this because we had a lot of new venues going in here, so that was probably helpful. We upgraded the water supply from the reservoir, which was quite far up the valley. We built a new medical clinic, volleyball arena, 200 new equestrian stables because the equestrian center was on this venue as well, and a horse hospital, which they didn't have before, and that we needed for the Olympic Games. This was a year before the Olympic Games. You can see by the number, it's 2015 at the bottom. On the very left-hand side, at the top, that is the mountain, the hill climb for the mountain bike. And this is X Park, what we call X Park. It had three sports, a mountain bike. On the horizon here is the canoe slalom course. And on the other side of that hill is BMX. So that site was 125 acres. And that's me in the front there. This is the team of the core of my team who are designers and builders. We see while looking at our maps and our drawings, and we all have these extended CAD books of how things are going. We're actually trying to figure out here the finish start line for the mountain bike track. It didn't look like that when the games happened, but there's a lot of earthwork and a lot of development that happens. So this was halfway through. This is just the canoe slalom course. We were standing down here at the bottom, about here, when the previous picture, and there's a hill here, and on the other side is this canoe slalom course.
Excuse me, canoe slalom?
Yeah,
canoe slalom. What is a canoe slalom? It's on a horse.
It's like a whitewater
raft. Whitewater.
We use them on the little rivers and things here. At the Olympic level, it's quite sophisticated. And not very natural necessarily, but pretty sophisticated. So this takes up probably half of that 125 acres of land. In the very center of it is the water course and the water resource. And the rest of it is supporting areas, broadcast pubs, spectator areas, roads, infrastructure. So there's quite a lot of earthworks that we did for that particular venue. This is what it looked like at the Olympic Games a year later. So you can imagine there's quite a lot of work went into that. The construction company that I worked with, we met every day at 7 o'clock in the morning to review where we are, what we need, how to make sure this all happens. And it's quite amazing what you can do when you're motivated. See, the thing I like about the Olympics is it has a deadline. The competition is going to start whether you're ready or not. And I sure don't want to have egg on my face and not be ready. Neither does anybody else, especially if you're the host nation. That's not a very good scenario. So there's a tremendous amount of pressure to get the deadline. And when you're building a building or a road in the public, if it extends, it's not great, but it's not the end of the world. We don't have that option. I kind of like that. Because you gotta get on with it. Get moving. There's no excuse. You've had 7 years, you've been told about it for 7 years, so time to get it done. Anyway, let me just take you quickly through this. These are the, let me see if I can get over here. These are the seating area, public seating area. This is 8,000 seats there. This is the competition course. At the top here is the preparation area for the athletes. This is a ramp that takes them from the pool, the warm-up area, and there's a warm-up course here. So this is in fact two competition courses so they can get prepared. This building here is underneath is the pump station. It moves about 2,500 gallons of water per minute down the course. That's quite a lot if you know much about moving water. They're pretty big pumps. Everything back here is all what we call back of house. It's not public space. These are all service areas for activities that happen. The broadcast and press centers. This is the athlete preparation area here. Each of the competing nations has a little tent so they can get in there and get their competition uniform and their boots ready and all that kind of stuff. In that little building is all the services for them. Anti-doping testing, meals if they need, medical service, etc. Now, the earthworks that you saw was mostly back here, and that is a roadway that the spectators use, and they come all the way down here to the rail station, the new rail station that we built with the new rail cars. Now, when I first arrived there, I'd never been there, of course, before, so I took the train up. It was, you know, those old movies with the Indian train with the curtains that blow out the window and it's 50 degrees in there? Yeah, that's exactly the train I was on to get from downtown Rio to there. Now, part of the Olympic project here was not only to fix the rail, but to get new rail cars. So they got all new rail cars with air conditioning, so the windows don't need to open, and it's not 50 degrees. So the rail station is up here. This is the security entrance path, and this is the medical building I was talking about that we built before. So that's just one venue. So for this particular games, I was doing a few projects like that.
Mike, does that still exist? Like
yes.
That?
Yeah, I'm going to come back to that in a minute. Mm-hmm. Now, every venue gets pretty much the same exterior treatment. The picture on the left is what's called a pit's fence. This is a security fence. You can't just walk into an Olympic venue, you have to go through the security entrance. So the entire perimeter of the venue is fenced. That's 3 meters high. This one's particularly out in the countryside, so it doesn't have the motion detectors and the cameras on it, but in an urban center, it does. And of course, that all goes to a security control center to make sure that people aren't trying to get into the venue. The top right-hand picture is the arrival area at Vancouver, at the Hillcrest Arena, where the curling was taking place. So there's some staff people there, and that tinted behind is what's at the bottom right. This is the security entrance. So you, in order to get into the Olympic Games, first of all, you have to go through the security, but you have to have one of these. This is accreditation. So these are some of mine that have like all these codes and letters and all that sort of business that are a sort of whole system of how you go, where you need to go, or things that you're not allowed to do with the staff in a venue like the canoe slalom. I would have a daily staff there of about 500. So we don't need everybody going around where all the athletes are, because if that's not your job, then you're not allowed to go there. But to get in the venue, I need this accreditation, and I also have to pass through airport security. Exactly the same thing we do now. Your bag goes through a magnetometer, and you go through an X-ray machine to check and make sure you don't have things you're not allowed to have. And they're as strict or more than you get at the airport. This is a photograph of Greenwich Park in London. This is the equestrian venue. It has all the same stuff we've been talking about. It's at 20,000 temporary seats. And in this case, this is the setup for jumping. In equestrian, the three disciplines at the games, one is dressage, which is the prancing horse. The second event is this, jumping, and the third is eventing or cross country. So there's a 7 meter or 7 kilometer course that happens behind this. This is at Greenwich. Now, Greenwich is a royal park, and you're not exactly mucking about. You're not digging trenches like we did in De Toro. In fact, you don't touch the grass. You don't cut the trees. You don't do any of that stuff. So you have to set up an Olympic. You know, this is entirely temporary. It cost, if you were interested, about 60 million pounds to do this. So we have to build this in such a way that it can be totally temporary and taken away. Now there's two sets of athletes at this venue. There's humans who ride the horses and horses who get ridden. They get exactly the same level of service. Now to be an Olympic horse, these are not any horse. These are what we call 4 or 5 star Olympic caliber competitors. They're quite expensive, but they get first class service just like the athletes do. So the box that they go in is what we call stable, but it's a temporary box there. It's not a shabby venture. Even though there's 270 of them for the Olympic Games, that has to be built here on site temporary. Same with the medical clinic. If one of these horses gets ill, they might need to have surgery, and it might need to happen immediately. That clinic and that hospital is here. It exists, it's built, and it's temporary for these Olympic Games. It's just quite a onerous responsibility.
When you say temporary, what happens to all those bits?
Well, in most cases, what we try to do is to, they're part of the gypsy movement. So a company will own all those seats, and they will rent them. So that when they're finished, they'll take them away. This particular company was from France. It's GL event, and they own all those seats. They built them to the specification we require, and then they take them away. Because you can't touch the grass here, we had to build the field of play 1 meter off the grass. Well, that seems pretty reasonable, except that it's 80 meters by 100 meters. That's a very big field of play, and it has 400 metric tons of sand, and not just any sand. There's a very specific mixture of the material, which is about 10 inches deep, of sand and wax and fiber that goes into making an Olympic field of play, and a lot of water. So there's a tremendous amount of weight involved here. So this is how we did it in London. Now, I was also responsible for the design of the venue in Paris, which is coming up. Now, this one took place at Greenwich, and the idea at Greenwich was we'll have this brilliant camera shot, which is going to make England and London look spectacular. And from the top of it, if you've been to Greenwich, you know that view is quite beautiful. But imagine if you were now looking from the top of that view across that field of play with horses jumping, 20,000 fans going crazy, and flags all over the place, and you go across the Thames into the city of London, and you see St. Paul's and all of it. Wow. Very impressive. That's why they did it there, because it would be very impressive. Well, the French don't like to be, you know, outdone. You know about the French. So the project I worked on in France was to host the equestrian venue at the Palace of Versailles. I was thrilled to work at the Palace of Versailles. I've been there, but I've never worked there. What a lovely place. Busy, but lovely. Now it has the same problem. It's a World Heritage Site and one of the greatest in the world. their idea is to, at the end of the Grand Allée, is all the pools and the gardens on the side. And at the end is a very large area where we're going to build that field of play. So 1,000 seats again, new rail station to connect you into the city. The camera shot, which I had to keep reminding the design people, is if you build that stage, the field of play too high and they miss this camera shot, your life will come to a very brief end. Because the camera shot is from exactly this height, across that field of play, across the ponds in the gardens, up the Grand Allée, and 2 kilometers away is the palace. I think they've outdone the Brits. It's yet to be seen, but it was very exciting to do that kind of project under the same kind of strict conditions, because there is a World Heritage Site. You also don't touch the grass or cut the trees.
Mike, did they tell you where to build that, or did you suggest that?
Well, no, they had already suggested how they thought it might work when they made the bid. What they didn't know quite was exactly how they would do it. That's often the case. You know, you sell a great idea, I can kind of 50% get there. You get a few people who actually can get us the rest, which is my job. So just before we take a little break, I want to give you a couple of short stories of what I'm going to come on to after the break. This is a photograph from the transit or transportation control center in Rio de Janeiro. Now, I happened to be there the day they were doing the traffic test. They do a lot of kinds of traffic tests, but this particular test is, the objective here is to take a dignitary from the airport downtown through the center of the city to the stadium with no delay. It can be done, you know, they control all the lights and make the thing go through. So that they were doing that test on the day. Now, for at least 2 Olympic Games, there is a comedy series that is called like a mockumentary of the Olympic Games, and I'm quite certain that some of my gypsy colleagues are either on the writing team or somehow associated with it, because the stories that they're using are real, and then they throw a little twist. So the twist on this story is from the London comedy show, where they do this test, and the guy in charge of that makes a big deal about how it's going to all work. And the result is a gridlock in the city of London for 3 days as a result of having turned all the lights and a big problem. Well, that doesn't quite happen, but it's pretty funny. So the next one before we take a break is this. This, if you are a non-military person, is a surface-to-air missile launcher. London is, like many major centers in the world, is under various levels of terrorist threat. And as the Olympic Games comes forward, it generally goes higher. So the Royal Army and the security team decided that it would be probably prudent to prepare for the worst case scenario. So they put a number of these rocket launchers in East London to kind of protect against any threat that might be coming. You'll see that's kind of fenced off, and those are these are canisters for the rockets. The cabling underneath is all because it's electronically set off, and the houses are filled, and people live there. They put one of these, what did they call it, without people knowing, on the roof of their apartment building, which was only a few blocks from the Olympic Stadium. They were told to do that with discretion in the proper British way. They did it with a Chinook helicopter, which sat over the apartment building for about 20 minutes. hovering while they lowered this. There wasn't very much about how that happened. It was a big controversy. Now, the comedy version of this scenario is that the radio frequency that sets this off is tuned to the same radio frequency as the opening ceremony fireworks. So, at the opening ceremony, off goes the firework, and off goes the firework. That didn't happen, but it sure was fun. But let's take a little break, and then we'll come back with some more of the good and the bad and the challenging of hosting and organizing the games. Great. So let's carry on. I want to tell you about a few instances now of how things. You know, some of the really good things and some of the reasons that I have done all this work and enjoyed doing it, and a few circumstances which, well, really even challenged me. I have done this kind of work for almost 40 years, and maybe 2,500 events, not necessarily all this big, but pretty big. So. It's pretty rare to run into a circumstance that I haven't seen before, which is very helpful for the staff. I was just talking to someone earlier about the 5,000 people who will be working under me at any given day at the Olympic Games. So they kind of look to someone with a little calm and a little experience who can kind of sort the wheat from the chaff and get things moving. Over a period of time, they become pretty good at that. So some of the things that happened are quite predictable for the Olympic Games. Some of them are even a surprise to me, but some of them are really good. And I want to talk a bit about some of those to start with. When you decide to host the Olympic Games, the first question you ask yourself is, why are we going to do this? The question you ask, it goes over budget all the time. It's enormous. The impact on our community is going to be devastating. We probably should spend the money on something else. Yet, many cities and many countries still continue to request a bid and to host the games. Now, I'm going to show you a couple of examples of why they do it. This is London. This is East London. The foreground here is the area around the Lee River, which runs vertically through the image here. Now, for 400 years, this was an industrial site. The land is completely contaminated with heavy metals, arsenic, mercury. The river itself is dead, or was dead. And you'll see the stadium being built in the center of the image there. So we're partway through this project. The idea in London for this particular area was no government or private sector would ever be motivated to deal with this problem. The cost of retrofitting this soil and the 800 derelict buildings there would be they're completely prohibitive. However, it's in a major city in England, and you can't ignore it. You've ignored it for at least 250 years. You can't keep doing that. And they know they needed to do something about it, but here was an opportunity. And that's one of the great things about the Olympics. Apart from being an opportunity for the athletes, it's an opportunity for a host. And the case of this, the opportunity was to fix this. So what they did is they restored this land. It's 2.5 square kilometers. That industrial park. They treated 1.1 million tons of contaminated earth. I don't know if you know how big that is, but that's a huge pile. It's probably 300 feet high by 500 feet at the base. This is an enormous pile of earth. They treated it for all of those carcinogens and heavy metals. They removed the 800 derelict buildings that were there, and they did it on site. which meant building a treatment plant on the land. Now that was a pretty innovative idea, because most of the, this is very highly sophisticated work. But in order to do that much volume, it would mean burning how many hydrocarbons to get the trucks to move it to a site that already existed. It's ridiculous. The damage to the environment would have been beyond. So they built this, the restoration equipment on site. That also saved them 70 million pounds in the project itself, and eliminated 28,000 tons of carbon emissions by doing
Can
it.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
Did London City have to fund
no.
a loan, or where else would the money have come from?
Well, that's one of the other interesting parts about hosting the Olympic Games. And it happens at all games levels, whether we do it in Canada as a national sport or a national competition or at the Olympics. It has to involve the national government. And in this case, this project has very little to do with the City of London. It's on their land and it's for their benefit. But this project was funded by the federal government, the British government. The Crown paid for this. It's a very expensive project, but it was an opportunity to fix a very long-standing problem and rebuild East London. The village where all the athletes live is built here. Now, this is where people live. Our main control center for all of the communications at the Olympic Games was designed in such a way that it would become a school after, an elementary school. So we used it, you know, for all the stuff we needed for, and within 3 months after we're out of there, it converts to a public school, and the people who need a place to live moved, or the athletes move out, they move in. So it completely transformed the whole east end of London. And for me, that's a worthwhile reason to do it. So this was the Lee River before. Well, you've all seen a dead river before. It's not particularly nice. This is the same area during the Olympic Games, and you see at the bottom is the Lee River through to the right. These plazas, which are now used as plazas, were the main spectator flow areas for about a million spectators who came to that park every day during the games. And the river itself has completely regenerated all the flora and the fauna that was originally there 200 years ago. They're very careful about this sort of thing, and so it has the right vegetation, and the fish are in the river, and the fowl is there as well. And of course, most important for people who live near there, it's a public park, so they can use it as such. This is in Vancouver. The top left is the Sea to Sky Highway. Now, if you've been to Vancouver or Whistler, where this road goes from Vancouver to Whistler, that road of the past, which I was born in Vancouver, so I used to ski there. That road was not particularly nice. It's a regular two-lane highway going through the mountains to get there. Part of the vision of the Vancouver Games to create a much better transportation corridor between the city and the tourist destination of Whistler Blackcomb. So that road, of course, when you build that road, it's not there for the Olympic Games. It's there for the next, I don't know how long, 50 years, 60 years maybe. And it has a tremendous long-lasting benefit for the people who live at Whistler or in Squamish on the way up, or the tourists who come from all over the world to ski in the winter at Whistler. The bottom right picture is the SkyTrain. Now, most big cities have some kind of public metro service. In Vancouver, it's called the SkyTrain. They thought that it was necessary to add to their their SkyTrain system, a line that would go from the waterfront station right downtown on the water, right through the center of town, past City Hall, out to Richmond and to the airport. So if you've been to Vancouver, you can take this SkyTrain now for $8 from the airport to the waterfront station. Now, that's fantastic because the people who work out there can take the SkyTrain and don't bother driving your car and burning off fuel. You don't have to pay for parking. If you buy a monthly pass, I don't know what that costs, but it's a lot less than $8 to get out there to do your work. And same for the tourists who are coming in. Vancouver is a big tourist destination, so you have a piece of infrastructure that's very useful. The difficult part from those who work in the Olympic Games is that these projects are included in the budget of hosting the Olympic Games. So the researchers, you know, the university types who are saying, well, the Olympic Games cost way too much. They do cost a lot, but it's in part because of projects like this. I don't know what they cost, but the Vancouver Olympic Games, I think, was slightly under $8 billion Canadian dollars. Now, I know to run the competitions at the venues in the useful competition, it's maybe $2.5 to $3 billion to actually have the operation of the games. The other parts are things like this. Now, I think you can make an argument either way. This is tremendously beneficial to the Olympic Games, but it's also, and perhaps more beneficial, in the legacy for the community and for its economy. Either way, it's a good thing. And especially if you can lever, as a city, if you can lever the cost of this project with funds from other levels of government, which always happens. You build a major piece of infrastructure for something that the national government is the one in Canada that would be signing off on the Olympic Games. So they say, well, we're going to host the Olympic Games in whatever city. So that means you're kicking in. And we want to do this for the legacy. So you're going to kick into this project, and they do. That's generally how it works. In every region, it's the same.
What percentage of the money would come from outside the host country?
To like this $8 billion?
Yes, you said, okay, so much is, you know, government of Canada to do this, but I'm just curious, where does the rest of this come from, just around the world, or?
Yeah, it's, if you have between 5 and 8 million spectators, you can expect to get quite a lot of revenue from ticket sales and all the other stuff that goes with that. The Olympic Organizing Committee also contributes to this. Now, if you're a sponsor of the Olympics, there are major ones, like Coca-Cola and McDonald's and Corning and a number of others. They spend a huge amount of money, probably $500,000 a year, to become Olympic sponsors. That money goes to the International Olympic Committee, and they contribute as well, because that's partly revenue based on what you're doing there.
Do participants have to pay to enter the competition?
No. No, ma'am. In fact, part of the revenue, the profit that might be generated from this goes to the International Olympic Committee, and it goes spread from them back to the international and national sport federations to fund and pay for athlete programs in their host countries. So this happens with all Olympic sports, and that's part of the regenerative nature of how it keeps moving forward. This is the last one in this series of, this is the water pond at Kanuslawa in Deodoro. This picture was taken between the test event and the Olympic Games. Now, I don't know if many of you have been to Deodoro before, but just behind this venue is a very large favela. A favela is, they have roughly 200 of them in the city of Rio. It's a very, very poor neighborhood with almost no resources and no services. This community is probably 10 or 15,000 people who live there. They don't have water. They connected onto part of my pipeline, the makeshift connection, so they could get some water to the community. They do the same with the power, just throw a couple of lines over the, to get some kind of services. Now, when this was built, it gets to be 50 degrees here in the summer, which is pretty darn hot. And of course, they don't have air conditioning either. So we wanted to find out if they would find it useful to have a swimming pool. Now, we do this in their winter, and this picture was taken in January, February, in the summer. So the pool, normally the water for canoe slalom has straight sides and go down about 3 meters, which is what happens on the far side of this. But this side, we built steps, because it probably would be useful, if they like the idea, to have a swimming pool for this very poor community. So we opened it up. We thought maybe we'd give it a test and see if they like it. Well, we thought there might be some interest, but there was about 3,000 people there that day. So it definitely, and this is what it's used for today. You don't really need a canoe slalom course, with all respect to my colleagues in the sport and in Rio. You probably don't need that, but you certainly need this swimming pool. I mentioned that medical clinic. They don't have a medical service at all in this favela nearby here. That clinic that we built for the Olympic Games is now their medical clinic. Fantastic. I think that's a good reason to do it. Never mind the transportation system, which just helps to get them where they can live in a community they can afford to live in, and get on an air-conditioned transport into the city where they can have a good paying job and get back home without much trouble. So those are some of the positive things that I think inspire me about why you would want to host the Olympic Games. And those countries that have a good idea of why they're doing it probably have a pretty good legacy idea of how this is going to work. I'm particularly impressed when I meet any event that has a vision for what's happening after. Yes, it's valuable. Yes, it's a great drama. Yes, there's lots of people paying attention. That's all great. But you can do that, and you can stop there, but I'm not particularly interested in that. I'm interested in what you're going to do in the long term for this. How is this really going to benefit us? Me, our community, our sport, whatever it happens to be.
Does most of it come down to the infrastructure?
Yeah, the legacy often does, but you were talking about the sport piece. That's also an enormous piece to this. I mean, we just had the Indigenous Games here in Nova Scotia. Hugely successful event with 5,000 athletes. It's the same size as the Winter Olympic Games. It's massive. They've done a fantastic job. But what happens from that is not only, in this case, it's cultural and social, bringing people from different communities together. That happens at the Olympics too. But it also develops those sports, it develops the coaches, it develops the staff who learn how to, they've gone from running their little hockey events, now they're running the North American Indigenous Games or the Olympic Games, and they come back home, because I live here, I'm from Halifax. So I'm around and I can help all kinds of people, including the Indigenous Games. So some of the things that happen are predictable. It seems to always go over budget. About a year before the Olympic Games start, the media wakes up and they say, oh, this is coming up. Let's get our regular set of Olympic questions. Are you on schedule? No. Are you on budget? No. Are you going to get there? Oh, yeah, everything's going to be fine. It's predictable what happens. Lately, there's been a bunch more of these kind of items, like these illnesses, Zika, H1N1, pandemic, of course. We have now more issues regarding extreme heat. Tokyo and Paris are particularly concerned about what impact is that going to have on everything that happens there. And what are we going to do about it? How can we mitigate it? And how does that all fit together? There's always a local controversy about building, because sometimes they move a whole community and say, well, you don't live here anymore, because we're going to build whatever. Okay, well, they get moved. That's not particularly often well handled. So there's local issues. Yes, ma'am.
You were saying we're concerned about the Ukraine-Russian war.
Yeah.
And of course, we've had during the Second World War, there wasn't any Olympics, were they?
For two days, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I felt very much for the athletes. I still remember in the Winter Olympics that poor Russian figure skater. Touch my heart. They worked so hard to get there.
Mm-hmm.
And how have they chosen them not to? How is the system now? How are they meant to say you can't?
If you don't mind, I'd like to hold that question until after.
Okay.
So it's part of a larger context, and I need to put it in that context so that we can talk about that, if you don't mind.
Yes.
Thank you. Well, here's the poster child for the other problem we get all the time, which is doping. This is Lance Armstrong, the cyclist. He's not alone. It's not new. This has been going back since the 100 years. There's been issues of doping at the Olympic Games. I'll just tell you that one of the things that bothers me a lot is the athletes who don't get the opportunity to stand up in front of the spectators or their peers to be given their medals. Since 2008, the Beijing Winter Games, there have been 110 athletes who've lost their medals because of doping. And that, of course, means that at least another 110 athletes have received a medal without the accolades of their peers. And that's a terrible shame. I don't know how you fix the problem except do what they're doing, which is control under the control of the World Anti-Doping Association is to control the doping. If you want to talk more about that, I can do that later as well. The other fellows that are on the screen here represent really the other thing that happens. It seems to happen all the time. This is the issue of corruption. Now, the top right-hand corner is Carlos Nuzman. Nuzman was the head of the Brazilian Olympic Committee and the chairman of the host organizing committee in Rio. He's currently in jail for 31 years for corruption. He used money from this Olympic budget to buy some boats to get the games. He paid a fellow in Africa who said, I have all these people with me. If you give me the money, they will vote the way you want. It's not new. We've seen this before. The fellow on the bottom right with a big smile on his face, I don't think he's smiling much these days. This is Sergio Cabral. He's the governor of Rio. He blew the whistle on Nuzman because he was under attack for corruption as well. So because he was part of the deal for what Nuzman was up to, he got 14 years in jail for that. But he's really not smiling because he got another 45 years in jail for embezzling money. So part of your money that disappeared from your overall budget, in this case from me and my colleagues who were trying to put the schemes together, he peeled off a nice piece of money just for himself. The bottom left is Takeda, who's done something similar, although he's not in jail, he's been in alleged to have done the same thing as his colleagues. This is, if we want, we can keep going back further and further. But it really tells you that they're prepared to do quite bizarre things in order to host these games. And once they're in this driven by this target, these people will do almost anything to make that happen. I don't particularly like this much, but it is a reality.
And Mike, before you leave, things happen. Mm-hmm. Let's not forget what happened in 1996 in Atlanta, the Summer Games.
Yeah,
and
72 with the
Well, exactly.
I mean, there's lots of incidents where we've have pretty
major... Well, what major... good job you do with security. I'm more always surprised when it doesn't happen. I don't know if lessons happen more.
Oh, they definitely have. It's very strictly controlled. The whole security operation is a very, very complex piece. It happens both at the venue level, but coordinated across the whole city, the whole country is involved. And in the case of, for example, London, because I worked in such a high position, I'm involved with discussions that involve national defense and international terrorist activity. So there's a pipeline that connects all this together.
It's of course, it ended up being homegrown in Atlanta, but it's still scary to think that it's any level of terrorism.
Frightening. Absolutely frightening. So I want to tell you about a couple of things that surprised me. This, it's not a great photo, but I took it because I was a little scared and I thought I better have something up record of this. The very top of the picture is a mountain bike mountain in Deodoro. Those white things in the front of the back of house tents for services at the X Park. And the fire is a fire. Now, in that favela and not further up the valley from this, there is a tradition in these rural communities to build a plastic balloon, attach some lines to it with a basket, and in the basket you put a candle. And of course it heats the air, and it's great to watch. I mean, they go off into the sky, and at night they send them off. So they send lots of these. They know they're not supposed to do it, but it's fun to do, and they've been doing it forever. Well, they come down, and this happened to me twice at this venue. One of them came down, probably the size of that table there, at the canoe salon next to the run. Didn't do any damage, but scared us a little bit. This particular one landed on the other side of the mountain in the grass savanna and caught on fire. And that fire was blowing. You know what happens. We have had one very recently, very close to us here. It's a terrifying experience. And this fire was blowing at the venue. So it came to get our attention. The top left is the mountain, of course. You can see the green central part, but on the left of that is all brown. That's burnt. The fire came that close. And, you know, those of us who live around here have seen this before, with this fire out in the forest. It's a terrifying thought coming. The bottom right is a close-up of what happened. The very right-hand side is the competition course. This is where they ride the bikes. The top part of the mountain here, this is a rail cam for an OBS broadcast camera. And what happens is the starts at the top here. They're going somewhere around 40 to 50 kilometers an hour, downhill over boulders and rocks. It's unbelievable what these athletes are doing. And in order to shoot this, they run this camera along with them, so that you can see what's happening. It's fascinating broadcast, but in this case, the fire burnt all the cables that connect that to the control center, and you can see that it stopped right at the field of play. That's what stopped the fire, was our competition course. This happened a week before the Olympic Games started. This was, for me, one of the most beautiful mountain bike courses in the world. I have done a few of them before. This was spectacularly beautiful, and I was terrified that this was going to wipe out the whole course. But it was not great. However, we did survive it, and the fire went up and had a great competition. This is the rugby stadium. Now, rugby was the first time it was in the Olympic Games, the rugby sevens. Rio. The Men's World Cup 15s is happening right now in France, but this was smaller version, seven aside. So this used to be a polo field. If you know anything about elite athletes, they don't play rugby on a polo field. That's not really the right way to go about it. So we had to build a proper field. So dig it up, put irrigation, put gravel, drainage systems, put some proper soil on the top. And then the decision was, this was about a year, roughly, a little less than a year before, the decision of how you're going to put the grass on it. Now, grass grows really well in Brazil. It's quite warm, rains a lot. You put some seed, you should have no problem. So we decided that's how we're going to do it. The grass, if you know anything about growing grass, you need water. It didn't rain. So we got a problem. Now the Federation, the Rugby Federation, this is the first time they're in the Olympic Games, and they're very nervous. I could be too. I want this to go well. I've been trying for 50 years to get my sport in the Olympic Games. We're finally here. And the pitch, what are we going to do if this pitch is not ready? So, of course, they say, Mike, you're the guy? What's going on? Yes. How come this isn't working? You know, if this didn't happen. Yeah. So I spent a great deal of time trying to mediate to find out what's happening with this venue. The issue here is, like a lot of other things, we didn't quite get all the pieces to deliver at the same time. The water tower was there, it was full of water, that's great. You do need a little electricity to run a pump, and if you don't have electricity or a pump, you only have water, which was the case. And they would, the construction guys would say to me, yes, we're well aware. Semana que vem, which is Portuguese for next week. This will happen next week. Well, we do this in, I don't know if you've been around, but we do this all over the world. They do, in the Middle East, it's inshallah, right? God willing, something will happen. We do it here, so, oh yes, we're working on that. It's the same principle, it's not really happening. Yes, ma'am.
Have solar panels started to be used? Then you wouldn't have to run long cables.
It's a little hard because the volume of electricity here is so high. We don't like to use generators, although they do come into play back up. In Paris, they have a great, they're mostly nuclear power. So it's a little easier to manage that way, but we don't use solar because it's temporary and it's very expensive to set up on a temporary basis. This part ran off of the national power grid. So we built a new substation that is now used by the community, but we built a new sub-power station for the entire park.
But in future, with the way you were talking about leaving infrastructure in place for the benefit of the community, those solar panels would be wonderful to leave behind.
They would.
So I guess I'm trying to persuade you, but...
Well,
but
unfortunately,
not sure
I'm not one to persuade you,
oh,
but I think you can't keep doing it the same old way.
Yeah.
I think you've got a point. And there's the technology is moving so fast that it will eventually become. Hydrogen is also, especially because it runs generators, that can generate enough power for what you require for this. That's also a very efficient way of not burning fossil fuels. Much better result. Now, I can tell you what I did here to solve this problem because I was terrified we weren't going to have grass. So I had a truck in the park, and I drove around the park, and I picked up every piece of pipe or hose that I could find. And I found this big piece of red hose, and I attached that to the water tower. And those were just bits of pipe. You know, you kind of stick one into the other. And I put them out into the middle of the field, and I opened the valve in the water tower, and I flooded the rugby field. Well, guess what happened? The grass grew really quickly. And so I came back, and the guy said, where's the pump and the electricity? He said, oh, yeah, see what I'm giving. Well, all right, so can you put more water in the tower? Oh, yeah, they need lots of water. So they filled up the water, and so for a week, I flooded this field every day. And then the Rugby Federation fellow came, and he said, that's the answer. That's what we like to see. And of course, when you do a test, and the roots are like down. Yes. So after the competition, the head of the federation gave me this competition. Yeah, it's not the gold medal game,
yeah,
because that went to the winner. But it is from the 75. You're a good guy.
Beautiful.
So you saw some pictures earlier that this the Deodoro was a jungle. It definitely is a jungle, and animals live in the jungle. There's a number of these alligators. This river was dead and quite awful, but that fellow lived there. He was there the entire time I was in Brazil, 4 years. This python was in the end of the mountain bike course and the start of Kanuslala. This was his home, he lived there, but needed to not be living there. So I asked him, he's about 4 meters. I don't particularly like this animal, but they deserve to live there. It is their home. So I asked the fellows in charge, and they said he was relocated. I said, well, does that mean he's relocated here, or relocated him in a cage? To said, oh, no, he went in a cage, and we moved him to another part of the jungle. Thank goodness. I'm sorry that this is really difficult to see, because this was one I had to take quickly. This is the sort of eyeball you can see here. This is an alligator. And you can see his legs here, and feet here, and a tail off the screen. This picture is taken underneath the volleyball arena. Now, we park our cars as we're coming into work, lower down, and we walked around to the front of the arena. And so when we park the car, we come and see, you can see underneath the arena. And this is one morning, we found this fellow there.
Is that the parking lot there?
No.
Well, you know, it kind of looks like that would be a parking lot, but those are stone slabs that are underneath. Okay. They're not the size of parking lot.
That's a big alligator.
Yeah, it's kind of one of those fake. But he is about 3 meters long, and those are more stone slabs that were protect the earth underneath. So it's a little surprise that I could have lived without. In Vancouver, this is Vancouver, Cyprus. Vancouver was the Winter Games in 2010. What we call the no snow, no winter Winter Games, because it was. Blossoms were out, and in this case, the Cypress Mountain is closer to Vancouver than Whistler, but they didn't have any snow. Now, my colleague, who was did the same job as I do, but on this venue, in November, said, this is not good. Snow is not coming. We've got an issue. I can't. The alternative is this has got to go to Alberta. Well, that's a whole other issue. It's very complicated, not fair to the athletes because they don't get to live in the village with everybody else. Doesn't look good, all kinds of stuff. So Stuart came up with a plan so that any snow that happened from November, the games happened in February in Vancouver, it started at the end of October. He arranged to collect all the snow from the whole valley. And he put it behind that little hut up there. There's a big valley in behind there. And he moved all that snow into that valley. So this picture was taken before the Olympic Games, and all the snow is in behind. So it all covered and kept collecting, just in case we didn't have snow. But they didn't get snow. So just before Christmas, we were in a meeting with the kind of heads of these sections, and Stuart said, I'll see you at the end, because I got a little project to do. And we all knew what we had to do, which was to make a field of play. So he spent the next 3 months with a huge array of heavy equipment to move the snow out of that valley and build a snowboard competition, and to build a snowboard competition course with the snow from the valley. It worked. It was a very good competition. Canada did particularly well. And the cameras, of course, they have a long, we call it a beauty camera. It was from a long ways coral love, beautiful mountains and all that. Well, they didn't really use that so much because there wasn't much green around. It all looked green.
It looks so good.
So we did a lot of tight camera shots on just the field of play where the snow was. And when the story was, oh, you know, we didn't get much snow this winter. It panned out. So it was a bit of a challenge, but not one that happens that often, but may happen more, right? We're heating up. This is the Chile flag and China. Now, if you win the competition and you get the gold medal, there are the three of you, right? Gold, silver, and bronze. So you have a ceremony, and you're awarded the medals, and the very sophisticated and organized protocol team makes this all happen, and then they play the national anthem of the gold medals. In this case, this happened in London, the production team was early on, and China had won the gold medal, and in the production booth, they have all the national anthems. Sometimes they record them so they're all uniform and very specific and exactly they're coded and all the rest, like a kind of radio station approach. So if you know about your the list of nations that compete and start with C at the Olympic Games, Cambodia, Cameroon, Canada, Central Africa, Chad, Chile, China, they're right beside each other. Well, unfortunately, the poor fellow who played the national anthem hit the wrong cart and created a major diplomatic incident by playing the Chilean national anthem for the Chinese athlete. To stop it and restart it was as bad as playing the wrong one. So it meant a little revision to their protocol to eliminate the countries from the deck that are not competing, so at least we get rid of that problem. And that happened to be the only incident of that nature, but it's a bit terrifying when that happens. This is from Pyeongchang in 2018. Now, for any host nation, in the team sports, you are allowed to put a team into the competition, whether you qualify or not. Now, in the case of women's ice hockey, Korea does not qualify. They're not even in tier one of women's ice hockey. But they wanted to put a team to represent the country into the competition. They don't really have a lot of athletes, so they thought, let's try something. Let's put South Korea, North Korea together. They had a coach, I don't know if you watched the ice hockey at that time. They had a coach, Sarah Murray from the United States. This was in one of the arenas that I was responsible for, so I saw this whole drama unfold. They didn't know each other, they'd never practiced together. They certainly didn't know this coach. And she was spectacular, an absolutely brilliant person for the job, and she did a great job of coaching them to get them ready. I watched all their practices, and they were very tentative at the beginning. They didn't. The only thing that was in common, they spoke Korean. The rest was all new to them. Now, this picture was taken after they scored after the match where they scored their one and only goal in competition. The roof came off this building like you would not believe. It was a great moment. The white cards that they have here, they chose to have that represent the peace and homogeneity between their two countries. Well, they're technically, you know, still at war. There's lots of issues still involved with their neighbors to the north, but this was one of the great moments. Collaboration. Well, back to the drama. There's little bits. I've showed you little bits of of the drama along the way. Let's kind of close off this race with what happened, if you don't remember what happened.
On your mark.
Oh, they're away, and Gatling got away brilliantly, and he's ahead of the field at the moment, and Bolt going very near. Comes Usain Bolt! Usain Bolt storming through, he takes it again, Blake gets the silver, 9.64! Oh, he's retained his title in the most emphatic way! Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant! Usain Bolt of Jamaica is the fastest man on the planet. 9.63, a superb demonstration of power sprinting. What a performance that was. Gatlin attacked early, but Bolt got into his running, really. It was an unbelievable run, and Blake, I think...
We've seen that move before. What a brilliant athlete, and what a brilliant performance. And for him and for us, that was the end of this build-up and the drama. We finally could release. You heard at the very beginning of the race, it's dead silent. I don't know if you've heard 80,000 people not make a peep before, but it'll take your breath away. You can hear, I was sitting at the finish line, and you can hear the refrigerators on the concourse. It's so silent. But you know what's coming, and of course, as soon as the gun goes off, it is huge, absolutely huge. A wonderful experience for everybody, in particular if you win a medal. What a great moment. this is the women's eight rowing that won the gold medal. This is really what it's all about, and that's why we do it, because of what happens for and to these athletes. So, you know, you'll never see a picture of me in this scene. If you do see a picture of me in this scene, there's a really big problem. Because this is what you want to see. The drama is what you want to experience, not the drama that I go through. That's irrelevant. We do that for the purpose of this. That's why we do it. Usain Bolt and other athletes have said the same thing, that my competition takes less than 10 seconds, but I'm at least on a 4-year preparation cycle to get ready for that. And in the case of Olympic athletes, it's at least 2 more cycles to get to that point. It doesn't happen overnight. I don't know if you noticed how many steps he took. Did anybody pay attention? He took 41 steps. I can guarantee he knew exactly what was going to happen on every single one of those steps. What his balance needed to be, how much power he needed to add, what reach he needed to have. And it changed throughout throughout the race. But he knew exactly how that was going to work. All Olympic athletes know that. You can't get to that level unless you know exactly how this is going to work. Well, it is the same for me, except I don't do it in front of the camera or the public, and I don't do it for a gold medal. But it's the same steps. I have to do exactly the same amount of detail. I have to know exactly what's happening, when, and where, and all those 25,000 questions for each thing. So when I talk with my team, among a lot of other things that we talk about, this is the one that really sticks with me. It doesn't just apply to the Olympics. For me, it applies to all kinds of things and all kinds of parts of my life and my family. So, if not now, when? And if not you, who? I think that's a good lesson. Thank you.
Here's your gold medal.
I'll take some questions.
I just want to make a comment about the fact that you're standing or you're sitting in Queens County, which has an athlete who's Sarah Midden, who is wow. And we can all sit back and watch all of our competitions.
She'll be there.
She'll be there.
Yes, ma'am.
They have an Olympic wall at the Ameri Center with the Queen.
Yep.
I don't know if you've seen it or not, but it's...
Is there a big sponsor, particularly here in Nova Scotia?
Yeah.
And Lockport has an Olympic athlete.
That's right. Yeah.
We have lots of sailors from Nova Scotia as well, paddlers from the town.
I asked you earlier, how did you get from the Stratford stage to this? You said you just started in Halifax with something.
Yeah, my background, for those of you who are not familiar, I trained as an opera singer. I have a music degree and a business degree. So I used to manage symphony orchestras in Toronto and here in Nova Scotia. And then I worked as an impresario for 25 years or so. And I happened to be working at the Trade Center in Halifax, and we were trying to build a performing arts center, which hasn't happened yet. That's another story. But while I was there, they asked if I might help them with the World Ice Hockey Championship. I was doing the lacrosse is my sport, and so I was organizing the World Indoor Championship, which took place in 2007. And so I started to work on the Ice Hockey Championship. When my boys were away at university, and a friend said, well, if you're interested in this kind of stuff, just give me a call. And I got an opportunity to work in Vancouver. This was my first Olympic Games, and that started me off. I have to tell you, I was 50 years old at the time I did that, but I was absolutely terrified. The thought of working on something which we kind of idolized was a bit intimidating. But I found the only thing that was different between what I was doing, organizing cultural kind of things, and what they were doing in the Olympics, is that they swear differently. Everything else is the same. And oddly enough, it's the same as you organizing your dinner party. It's those same five things.
You were going to talk about some ethical and associated issues.
Yeah. You were asking about the Ukraine and Russian athletes. Let me give you a little bit of context. There's something called the Olympic Truce. Now, this is a pledge which all the participating nations make on behalf of their athletes and on behalf of their nation when they compete at the Olympic Games. And the pledge is basically to not have any war or aggression between themselves and any other nation. It's not new. It existed in the ancient Olympic Games. And it started because the city-states would be fighting and warring. The city-state leaders would say, let's put this on hold. Let the athletes come to compete and then go back, and then you go back to your regular business. But during that, let's not complicate the matters. So the pledge still exists today, but we have one nation who has broken this pledge. In 2008, during the Beijing Olympic Games, Russia invaded Georgia. It was a military action despite having made the pledge. They invaded Crimea in 2014. That was during the Sochi Olympic Games. Their own Olympic Games, they did the invasion of Crimea. And in 2022, during the Winter Olympic Games, they invaded Ukraine, which is where they are today. The International Olympic Organization is not political, but it can't operate but in a political environment. So they violated their own the Olympic truce. Now what do we do? Now Russia has also got a little added problem with doping. Between 2011 and 2015, there was state organized doping program for which they've been sanctioned and penalized. So they've got a bit of a complicated problem. The International Olympic Committee response is that the athletes don't represent their nation. They are athletes. And what we want is for athletes to be able to compete against athletes. Now, they all come from someplace, but we can let those athletes from warring nation or those who have broken the pledge compete because that's what we care about, but not from Russia. So that's happened many times now to Russia. Those athletes are not allowed to compete under, they can't wear Russian flags, there's no symbols anywhere around, they don't play national anthem and give them a medal. You raise the Olympic flag and they compete under the Olympic flag. The same applies to the Belarusian athletes at the moment because they are also involved with the war in Ukraine and having broken the pledge. The dilemma here is how do we deal with those athletes? It's not a decision I make or you make. It's very complex. It's very political and stealth in Switzerland by the International Olympic Committee. There are lots of opinions about it. There's still lots of opinions about what's going to happen in Paris. The principle for the games themselves is the athletes are what we care about. Nations are not the issue. I don't know the answer. I don't know how it's going to resolve, but it is out there.
Thank you.
It's a very good point. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Our furnace magnus.
Just quick, going back to the bathroom in Vancouver, is that your original starting point? Vancouver?
Yeah, I was born in Burnaby, yeah.
You're a Burnaby?
I am, yes.
So, acting in Vancouver, you get started there too?
No, I was at music school in Vancouver. Acting started when I moved to Ontario. I went to University of Western University, and I lived there for quite a while. So it was there when I started.
Well, for information.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
I came in a bit late, Mike. I mean, you may have already addressed this, but there is a thought that all these billions of dollars they spent preparing these venues, why don't you go to Greece, set up some permanent venues, and we rejuvenate them as necessary, but just have one venue for the world?
Yeah, between the Olympics, it happens. That question comes up a lot. And there is a reason for it. First of all, because people want to host it, and they're prepared to go through that path of getting there. But the challenge here is that it's not just about the Olympic Games, it's about what you can do to leave a legacy in your community. So if you host it in one place, they have the financial responsibility to keep hosting it, but nobody else gets to build a legacy. They don't get to fix East End of London. They have to do it for a whole other reason. Well, maybe they never find a reason. There's no incentive to do it. It's also about the profile of your nation. Beijing hosted the first time Olympics in 2008. They gained an enormous credibility internationally because the event went very well, but they also gained profile. It's also about economic development in their cities and in their country. Imagine 140,000 people working for 7 years on a project. This has an enormous economic impact, both then and long term. It also has a very long term tourist impact. So, in the case of Vancouver, you may be able to see the Sky Highway, Whistler, Blackcomb is an enormous destination. When you put it on that kind of a stage, and you have a lot of options to where you want to go for your holiday to ski, I hadn't thought about Whistler. That's a good place to go. Let's go there. So the impact can last 10, 20 years, a generation. So as long as there's people who want to use it for the right reasons, there is a benefit to have. And there's a disadvantage to a country for the athletes who come from far away. They always have to spend a fortune to get there, and it's in a completely different time zone or with a completely different culture, and I always have to go to that same place. That's not fair, because the people who live within 100 kilometers, they live at home, they drive there, and it makes it very unfair over time. So those are the main reasons why it doesn't work. Yes.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for all coming. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you.
The gold medal goes to. We like at Scans to get your feedback on what we do, so we have forums that I think Jan has, or you can speak verbally to any of the committee members, or you can go online and just let us know what you think about our program. And also we want ideas, right? So please contact us with ideas like this. You can see how broad a range of things that we can do. So ideas for instructors, speakers. And of course, make sure you're on our mailing list. As effective, are you on your own members? I assume. So I'm talking to a converted here. And you know, of course, that we've got a great fall program coming up. We have Uncovering Your Roots through Genealogy, and then we have one called Understanding the Brain. So, how interesting is that? So, thank you very, very much for coming. Thank you.